All right, hello. Let me try to position this. Cool. Hopefully you guys can hear me okay. This is Lean Security for small and medium-sized businesses. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us. My name is John Chittenden. This is Anton Gomez. We're both security consultants for iSEC Partners. We're based out of New York City. As consultants at iSEC, we see a lot of different variety in both projects and clients. We see clients approach security in very different ways. Very often, you have the clients that try to bake security in right off the bat into their product. And then oftentimes you also see them retroactively sort of try to integrate security in. So from this, we get a diverse range of experiences and working with our clients on some of these challenges. And with that, we sort of wanted to package it up and provide, a reference material for a small to medium-sized organization. If, when you're trying to approach security and you're trying to implement a program, what are some things that you can do? What sort of a framework that you can use to implement a robust security program? Also, as a quick disclaimer, we might be referencing some services or products. We don't mean to vouch for those only. We just wanted to provide some concrete examples. So with that in mind, be diligent, do your own research. Here's the agenda for today. At a high level, we just wanted to introduce our concept in this framework that we sort of created based on a couple of different inspirations. Then we also wanted to provide some concrete recommendations that in the context of our framework, can really help you produce a robust security program. In addition, we're going to look at some real-world scenarios, some actual attacks that happened, and sort of compare that to the framework and see how it would hold up. So, like I mentioned, not every organization has that immediate need to satisfy security, right? If you think about a Maslow's hierarchy of needs for a startup, they identify a problem, right? They create a product that solves that problem, and then at some point they start to become profitable. And it's usually at that point that they decide, okay, we need to take security seriously. What do we actually do? And it's very often that a startup or a small company, they're very much focused on developing their product, making it bigger, better, faster, more features. And security is sort of the opposite of that sometimes, right? It can slow things down. It may not necessarily give you that sleekness that you're looking for in your app. So with that in mind, we really wanted to find some things that can enable your business to actually make a better product and a more secure product. And that's really what this graph depicts here. We wanted to find that sweet spot where we can really drive down the cost of security controls through lightweight, effective recommendations, but still drive down the cost of security breaches as well. The other thing that we wanted to accomplish, and I don't think it's very accurately captured in this graph, is that at the same time, you want to drive up the cost for an attacker. You want to be, not the lowest hanging fruit, if you will. So an attacker, they're very opportunistic, right? Generally, they want to just pwn as many apps as they can. And if you make your application a little more hardened, maybe they'll pass you up and find another victim. So here are some of the inspirations that we had. The technical details that we'll be discussing today aren't necessarily groundbreaking, but we wanted to package them up again and provide reference material for an organization that was, trying to implement their own security program. So with that in mind, it's a question that we're often asked is, how do we do security? How do we implement a security program? And I think you really just need to simplify the problem and break it up into chunks that you can actually manage. So infrastructure, application, and organizational. Today we're really going to be focusing on infrastructure security and application security. The reason being, right, is organizational processes are necessary and good, but if your company is only 50 people, it really doesn't make sense to have a bunch of business processes. Now I'm going to share a little war story, and I think this will help set the stage for our framework. Anson and I recently were on an engagement where we found a relatively benign infrastructure vulnerability. And then from that was our initial link in our exploit chain. From that, we were able to get domain administrator. We were literally a couple of clicks away from getting production client data. At this point, the client sort of tapped out and they said, okay, enough's enough. What do we need to do here? And they kept focusing on the initial link, right? The prevention. And I think they were missing something really key, because you can prevent a lot of attacks, you can limit a lot of attacks, but detection and response is equally key, right? You need to be able to perform triage for the instances that you're not able to capture, right? You can have a lot of different security controls that land in these different sort of buckets, but at the end of the day, you're not going to be able to account for everything, right? Security is not a binary event. Security isn't the output of some report that says that you're secure. The security controls that you have today can be ineffective tomorrow, right? Look at Heartbleed as an example of that. So you need to be able to detect and respond to events as well. And that's more or less what we want to talk about today. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Anson. He's going to talk about infrastructure security.
All right. So let's look at infrastructure security with regards to our framework. I mean, we spoke about prevention, which is the first thing. So what can you do to prevent an attack? I mean, the first thing is you need to know and understand your network. I mean, at the end of it's common knowledge that at the end of an assessment, a pen tester or even an attacker has enough knowledge or even more knowledge than the sysadmins themselves. So I mean, being a sysadmin or an invested party in the network, you need to know if a dev on the network is basically hosting a vulnerable service, or I just set up a new VM or a new Tomcat instance running default credentials, and you need to be aware of this. You need to stay on top of things. And I think that Nmap and Ndiff, with a baseline known good config, you can use these two tools, the free, that you can scan the network, periodically scan the network, and identify that, okay, there's this little system that's running, no one knows what it is, it strays away from the basic norm, I need to investigate this. That can help you stay on top of things. Network architecture is the next big thing. I mean, when you're a small organization, the temptation exists. You just want to plug in every device. Everything's connected to each other. You have a flat network. But that's not the way to do things. I mean, a flat network initially, when every device is connected to every other device, it makes it very easy to compromise the network in general. So try to avoid a flat network. And network architecture, if followed right at the very beginning, if you've got this design in place, you can, it's easy to set up. And in the long run, as the organization grows, it's easier to manage and maintain as well. So you've got your network set up. Now you've got systems on this network. You want to harden these systems as best as possible. I mean, number 5 on the OWASP top 10 is security misconfiguration. And when you relate that to network security or infrastructure security, what that means is basically, your services are misconfigured. Like we just spoke about someone hosting Tomcat, just a basic install of Tomcat, set that up, run that. The manager interface is exposed and it's got default credentials. So having default credentials on any network device is an absolute no. I mean, we've gone and engaged and we compromised a lot of systems just with default credentials. Additionally, you want to also make use of SSH keys rather than passwords wherever they're applicable. So you've got this, you've got your network, you've got your system set up. I mean, the next thing that you want to do is you want to follow the principle of least privilege. Speaking about the principle of least privilege, it just minimizes the attack surface that's available to an attacker to compromise a system. In terms of deployed systems or deployed servers, you just want basic set of packages on these systems, minimal installs as much as possible. So if you've got a server that needs a few packages just to run the application, that's all you need to install, nothing more, nothing less. Now the principle of least privilege can be also taken into consideration when you're having access controls. So access controls in a small to mid-sized organization, I mean, everyone has access to probably everything, like every dev on the network is probably admin on every device, has access to every device. It works in a small size company, but I mean, the moment you grow, this should be avoided. So you want to minimize the amount of access that is available to every other system. Production systems, firewall rules. I mean, we usually allow we don't want anyone on the internet being able to SSH into our production system. So SSH, remote desktop, any management services that you use on these servers should be firewalled off, and only appropriate systems should be able to access it. If you make use of a cloud service provider, something like Amazon AWS, then you can use security groups to do exactly the same thing. Additionally, AWS also has IAM rules and policies which can be used to restrict access to these systems. So the next thing here in this whole cycle is you've got all your system, you've got network set up, you've got your systems appropriately hardened and all that. But you know, you want to maintain that very same security posture. So patching and management is an important thing. Why do you want patching and management? Well, basically you want to prevent someone like Bad Luck Brian here, a script kiddie, from just running, you know, Metasploit's autopone on your network, on your servers, and basically compromising its security. So now with patching and management, I mean, this is a little, it's a little tricky. You need to come up with a proper policy and procedure. You need to, you know, understand what sort of a patch management process is good for you. I mean, critical vulnerabilities, yeah, they need to be patched as soon as possible. But you know, like some patches may affect the systems or the applications that that need those patches. So what do you do in this case? I mean, you weigh the business risk associated with that patch, with implementing that patch, and okay, maybe you know, if you've got a 30-day life cycle, a 30-day patch management cycle, maybe you need to tone that down to 7 days to address certain patches. Additionally, you know, with patching and management, what you want to do is you want to automate it as much as possible. The moment you automate this, I mean, there are different tools out there to automate this. You've got Microsoft's SEM, you've got Puppet. I really like Puppet. It's a really good tool. Helps you in not just automating your patch management process, but also helps in config management process. Additionally, it's got alerting in the sense that okay, so it's monitoring sensitive files in your system. Like let's say it's monitoring your etc shadow or etc password or etc sudo as file, and an attacker has compromised one of these compromised the system and is trying to make a change, trying to gain persistence. And makes a change to the etc/sudo file. The moment it changes, it deviates from the norm, it can trigger an alert. And if someone's actually monitoring this alert, you can stay on top of things and okay, there's something going on with this system. I need to investigate this. So patching, the moment you automate it, it saves time, and you can use that time to do a lot of additional tasks. That brings us to the second stage of a framework, which is basically limitation. So what can you do to limit the amount of the extent of a compromise? So one thing that I would really like to enforce here is enable two-factor authentication for any sensitive resource. Not just sensitive resource, but any mission-critical services, anything like VPN or Google Apps, or even AWS console access. Even the API support two-factor authentication. Make use of two-factor authentication as much as possible. It just enhances security. And in the future, you can take this a step further. Like you can have two-factor authentication for remote desktop access to certain sensitive servers, or even SSH for that matter. Now, the next thing you want to do is encrypt any sensitive data that's being stored. Let's say you make use of Amazon S3 for storing your log data, access logs, error logs. Sometimes this can contain some critical information if it's not sanitized. So you want to have, you want this information encrypted as much as possible. Now, if you're making use of Amazon S3, you've got server-side encryption, but you also got client-side encryption, where you can manage the encryption process, use the algorithms that you want to use, as well as manage the keys for the encryption and decryption process. On your internal networks, let's say you're deploying switches, routers, all these. Nowadays, all these network appliances come with inbuilt security features, features like dynamic ARP inspection, DHCP snooping, or even port security. However, they are all turned off by default. You need to enable this. As part of your deployment process, you need to enable these features. They just offer security out of the box, and they prevent a lot of layer 2 network attacks. The next thing you want to do is also implement, we spoke about network architecture. What you want to do is implement proper VLAN segmentation and ACLs. Now, when you use VLANs, you want VLANs for different business units. For devs, they stay in a separate VLAN, management stays in a separate VLAN, all your servers in a separate VLAN, and proper access control, when used appropriately, they enhance the overall security of the network. I mean, you don't want Suzy Q from HR just being able to SSH into your production web servers. You want only certain people on your network or certain systems on your network being able to gain access to your production environment. So VLANs and ACLs help out a lot, and you can also, with VLANs set up network choke points. So the next step in our framework is detection. What can you do to identify if you're actually being attacked? So we spoke about, cloud services. We've spoke, small to mid-sized organizations usually host, make use of Amazon AWS or any other cloud service provider. If you're an AWS, you've got a couple of services that you can actually leverage for this: CloudTrail, CloudWatch, Simple Notification Service, which is SNS. So what CloudTrail does basically is it logs every API call, every call to S3. And you can, use this information for audit purposes. CloudWatch, it keeps an eye out on all your CPU usage, your memory usage, things like that. So you can identify if someone's trying to cause a denial of service by trying to consume a lot of resources on those systems. And this information gets stored in S3. So if you are actually parsing all these logs, you can make use of the simple notification service to trigger an alert. Okay, the system is being overutilized at this point. What's going on? I need to investigate this. All this data, again, gets logged into S3, which technically becomes a centralized repository for log data. And that's what you want to implement. You want centralized logging. Why you want centralized logging? If you consume these logs appropriately with applications, something like Splunk, or you can use Greylog, Kibana, Logstash. Some of these are free, some of these are paid. So if you use these tools and consume these logs, it will help you make better business decisions as well as security decisions. When I say business decisions, all this log data that gets in it, that's accumulated into your centralized repository, you can identify there's traffic coming in at night from this particular zone. I need to probably change my marketing plan to advertise to these people in a better manner so that I improve my business. And it also helps in security decisions. This is what my normal traffic looks like, but if there's a peak, there's something going on. I'm talking about peaks and outliers, basically in log data. This means that you want to graphically represent this data. Looking at graphs and visualizing data helps out a lot. It just makes things much easier rather than reading through 10,000 lines of a log file and trying to find out one line where, this is where the attack actually occurred. But then you can look at a peak and say, okay, this is what happened. Let's see what's going on here. So if you've got logging and all this set up, you've got a centralized log repository. It really doesn't help unless you've got someone monitoring all of this. Now, monitoring can lose out on some sort of effort. You need some sort of effort, right? There's someone monitoring these logs. But if you set up alerting on logs, on events that have been identified, on this basic log consumption that you've done, if you can help that, it really helps out in detecting a compromise early. So it takes your incident response process and makes it a lot more proactive rather than reactive or incident driven. The next step in our framework is the response phase, and we were just talking about incident response. So let's see how you respond to an attack if an attack has happened. Let's say you're being targeted by a distributed denial of service attack. This Cloudflare, you can leverage its service. It says that it takes care of a little bit of distributed denial of service attack. So yeah, make use of it. Additionally, you need to have an incident response playbook, have a policy and procedure that outlines, this is the escalation path that I need to follow in such an event. And you also need a plan for business recovery and continuity. The next thing that you need to know is, communication with the public. It's got to be effective, efficient, and honest. There's always going to be haters, right? Haters going to hate. But if you have that positive and proactive communication going on with your user base, you will definitely get a positive reaction from not just the user base, but from the general public. And the final stage in this whole response process, identifying the gaps. Why did this attack happen? What could I have done to prevent it? How could I have prevented it? Could I have done something to detect it? So our whole process, our framework here is a cyclic process. If you can identify, I could have done this in the prevention phase to minimize an attack, or I could have detected the attack, you can seal the gaps right there. And that should probably, make things much better and help enhance the security of your organization. Let's look at common attack scenario, something that we've seen, a lot of times. So you've got an organization that has its production environment, and this is like the headquarters. So it's probably secured. It's got application servers. It's got an intranet network. It shows probably the wiki, HR systems, finance, payroll, and all of that. And then you've got a remote office or a trusted third-party vendor. And what happens in this case is there's always some system out there. I mean, it doesn't have the same security level as the main head office, and you know, it's probably a vulnerable server running. And now, though it is, you know, these are separate networks, they have to be joined. So there's an untrusted system that's connected to your trusted network. So, well, what's the worst that can happen, right? You got an attacker who's probably using Google, you know, finds this vulnerable server, finds an exploit for this for the vulnerability, manages to exploit the server, gets root on the server by probably privilege escalating. So once he's compromised the server, you know, since it's connected, it's an untrusted server and it's connected to your trusted network, starts Nmap port scanning and, you know, compromises the other servers. The way that he would do this is probably steal credentials from the users that log in into this one server that he's actually compromised, steal their credentials, and then start impersonating these users, gain access to probably production data, and then just start exfiltrating. So the exploit chain here is, I mean, since this is a very common attack, we've seen this in the recent target attack as well. So there's a compromise or a vulnerable system that's, you know, and it's on an untrusted network, but it's connected to your trusted network. And, you know, the attacker has used credentials that he has actually compromised earlier to pivot and maintain access on the network, and then just exfiltrate data. So our framework have prevented something like this? So prevention, you know, patch management. If you've got a proper patch management policy, okay, that vulnerability would have been patched, you know, and you would have mitigated that sort of an exploit attempt right there. The untrusted system, well, we've spoken about having a proper network architecture and maintaining proper access controls. So why have an untrusted system? I mean, you don't need your blog or something that's hosting WordPress connected to production, right? The next thing is limitation. So how can you limit the compromise of user credentials? Well, make use of two-factor authentication for any sensitive resource, especially production environment. If you want to get in production, two-factor authentication should be mandatory. And avoid the reuse of credentials, especially on sensitive resources. Exfiltration of data, this gets a little tricky. I mean, you need to be at a different level altogether. You need to identify egress filtering. You need to invoke egress filtering and on your network choke points. I mean, why is my production environment making DNS requests externally? Things like that should be monitored. So that's a common scenario. Let's talk about a real-life example. So we're talking about code space. I'm not certain if a lot of you know about code spaces, but let me give you a little background on this. So code spaces was it's somewhat similar to GitHub, where, you know, users could upload and store code and, you know, share with different users. And you recently just went out of business because they were compromised. And what happened was the attacker initiated a distributed denial of service attack. Whilst Codespaces was actually responding to this attack, the attacker compromised the AWS console, got access to credentials, and then created a backdoor, you know, probably a different set of credentials. But the attacker had a backdoor into Codespaces AWS console, and then he started extorting money from Codespaces. So when Codespaces you know, realized that they were actually compromised, and they identified, okay, this set of credentials was compromised, they rotated the credentials, but since the attacker had a backdoor, he got in, and since, you know, Codespaces hadn't paid him anything, he just started deleting everything, deleting the EC2 instances, S3, backup data. Now, this, you know, if Codespaces, this affected Codespaces even more because they did not have an offsite backup, and that led, you know, to them going out of business. So again, using our framework right here, it was, you know, with the exploit chain with distributed denial of service, compromised AWS credentials, created a backdoor, and then deleted data. So if you're talking about response, you know, Cloudflare would have helped in responding to a distributed denial of service attack. Compromised credentials, okay, you follow the principle of least privilege. Why do you need AWS credentials that can create other IAM roles or user accounts, right? Limiting, I mean, if you've got two-factor authentication enabled on your AWS console, that really helps. The attacker would have had credentials, but not the second factor, right? Created a backdoor. Well, AWS CloudTrail logging and alerting would have informed you about this. And deleted data, response, having a, you know, business continuity and recovery plan. Just key takeaways to summarize the infrastructure section. I mean, you need to know and understand your networks as best as possible. You need to enable two-factor authentication on any sensitive resource, service, or mission-critical stuff. You need centralized log aggregation, and you need to identify gaps and remediate any vulnerabilities, or just fix this, you know, the cyclic process. So that's it from the infrastructure. I'll hand the application section to John.
All right, thank you. All right, so now we'll talk about application security. And you know, using the framework again, we'll just start from the top and work down. So from the prevention perspective, there's a couple of just basic things that you can do. From the get-go, right, on day zero, choosing the right platform is really key. Most modern web frameworks can provide security controls that can help prevent a lot of the, you know, the very common web vulnerabilities, things like CSRF protections, input sanitization, and so on. That can limit your exposure to cross-site scripting and so forth. In addition, don't roll your own blank, where blank could be crypto library or authentication framework or access control framework. By using a modern framework that's open source and popular and supported by the community, you may gain exposure to libraries like Devise. So within Ruby, there's this authentication framework called Devise that will perform authentication for you, user creation, password reset, and all of that. And the beauty there is for your small to medium-sized company, you don't have to spend development time on that. It's provided for you, and now you can continue making better features and making your product ultimately better while still having that baseline of good security. The last thing here is just being diligent with your secrets. And I can't tell you how often attackers and consultants like Anson and myself, when we gain access to a source code, the first thing we do is just start trolling it for API secrets, framework secrets. If I can get your framework secret that's used to sign tokens, now I can start forging session cookies, right? Or if I can get your AWS API secrets, I can turn around and get that and try to access client production data, which is very damaging. A little more involved, I think the key here is just making security and privacy a priority. And I think it starts on day one. You know, when you start hiring your first or second developer for your organization, start asking them very basic questions about the security within your framework. Ask them if they know how CSRF works in Ruby, or ask them how input sanitization would be handled within Ruby. By doing that, they may not know those answers, and that's fine. But maybe during the onboarding process, you give them a free version of Burp and show them how they can, you know, request or, you know, capture requests and modify them on the fly. Once you start doing that, the idea is you want them to have that keen eye for security. And at the end of the day, hopefully they're developing more secure code. On top of that, you know, when they're doing peer review and everything, they might be actively looking for vulnerabilities in their peers' code. And again, you're capturing it before it even reaches production. So, you know, it's very common for organizations also to have like a continuous integration environment. And so you can start using tools like Breakman or FXCop and using them to capture very simple like web vulnerabilities. Breakman, for example, has a bunch of different filters that it looks for Ruby vulnerabilities. In addition, there's Fabricator. Fabricator is a code development platform that was created by Facebook that's open source. It's got a number of tools that allow you to monitor your source code, identify sensitive parts of it and changes to it, and then also facilitate code review, which again, you want to enable your developers and empower them to write secure code and identify issues. So moving down for limitation, don't store sensitive data in your database in plain text. You know, the obvious things like password and bank account and social security numbers make sense. But most apps these days also get OAuth tokens from third parties like Facebook or Twitter. And they don't encrypt these when they're storing them in their database. So when your database is eventually breached, you know, it's in plain text and the attacker can leverage that to exploit Facebook accounts. There's also exponential delays. This is commonly used for login, for protecting login against brute force attacks. I think similarly, this sort of idea and concept should be applied to API usage. You know, most organizations now, they're exposing public APIs, and we see that they're very commonly used by attackers to abuse them for privacy or security related issues. So, you know, providing some throttling, building that into your API framework is very effective. The other thing here is the concept of just transferring risk. If you're using a cloud infrastructure provider, in some respect, you are transferring some of the risk to them already. Similarly, if you use a third-party payment processor, you no longer have to store the credit card information, right? You no longer have to be, ensure that you're storing it in a secure and effective manner. You just hand it off to them, and then they store it for you, which is great. And again, two-factor authentication, we can't explain this enough. Honestly, use it everywhere. I think the other thing that you can really do here is just use it as an offering. If you're handling sensitive data, or if you're handling highly paranoid clients, if you can give them the option of using two-factor for your site, they're gonna respect that, and they're gonna know that you take security and privacy seriously. Now, with respect to detection within your application, there's a couple of things that you can do. Creating that just basic line of communication. Have that security tab where if a researcher clicks on that, he can contact you and say, hey, I found this vulnerability. And just by doing that, it creates that connection with the research community and the security community. In addition, we talk about crowdsourced security. And I think for a small company, this makes a lot of sense. There's a couple of different ways you can do it. Bad luck Brian here, when he finds that vulnerability in your application, give him the props, give him the shout out in your Security Hall of Fame, or consider a bug bounty program. I know there's the budget constraints around the bug bounty program, and there's also the false positive. Those are honest critiques of it. But at the end of the day, it's free security work, really. And it's going to raise the amount of effort. It's going to find all that low-hanging fruit and raise the effort for a real attacker. Finally, part of Fabricator is a tool called Herald. And I think Herald is really useful and interesting because it allows you to create rules and alerts around sensitive portions of your code base. So let's say your senior developer wrote a crypto library and your intern decided to go and modify it. This is a library that probably should never be modified. It's written once, maybe tweaked occasionally, but when your intern starts to tweak it, you'll want to be alerted and kick off that code review process. In addition, just basic error logging, capturing 500, 403, 404. If you're seeing a huge uptick in 403 and 404 responses from your app servers, that's probably a good indication that something fishy is going on. Maybe someone's running Durbuster on your site. And then, similarly with 500 errors, right? Like a SQL injection attack isn't pulled off with one single request, right? An attacker's got to fine tune his payload. And this will occur over multiple requests. So if you can capture this and alert on this, you're going to detect either incoming or inbound attacks. Then finally, Etsy has this library that's open source called StatsD. StatsD is really useful. It allows you to gather statistics on all sorts of facets of your application. It can help you make business decisions, but it can also help you capture security events. One such example would be if you see an uptick in password resets. That could be someone trying to enumerate and compromise an account. Similarly, I think it could be used around your API. Again, everyone is moving towards making public APIs, and the security of it's sort of vague. So just capturing usage of it and understanding how your APIs are used is going to help you detect potential attacks. Finally, within the response phase, I think the biggest thing is just identifying that security champion. You need that person that not only knows how to squash bugs and knows how to architect a secure application, but they need to be able to perform that triage and assign risk to the vulnerabilities that are identified in your app. You need this person to say, okay, we don't need to patch this next week. We can patch this 2 weeks from now when we have our security sprint. And similarly, you need to be constantly improving your other phases. When an incident does happen, you need to improve prevention, limitation, and detection. All right, so at this point, we're gonna sort of change gears and talk about some real-world examples. And I think one of the more interesting ones is with respect to a company called Buffer. So Buffer was a, essentially Buffer is a tool that allows you to manage posting to Facebook, to Twitter, and so forth. And one of the developers one morning woke up and he looked at his Facebook feed and saw, sure enough, there was all this weird spam coming from their Buffer app. And I don't know if you can tell, but it says literally, so-and-so posted this via Buffer. So this was an indication that something happened. This is how they were able to detect that something happened. It would have been great, you know, had they detected it earlier, but, you know, I guess this accounts for some sort of detection. But basically, an attacker compromised OAuth tokens and was posting on Facebook and Twitter saying, eat this Garcinia fruit. It's this weird mythological Amazonian fruit that helps you lose weight. And then from that, he got access to their GitHub repo. And then he started scraping all their API secrets from their repository. And once he did that, you know, his objective was just sending a bunch of spam through Twitter and through Facebook. So what could they have done differently? Well, they could have just not stored the OAuth tokens in plain text. That was the biggest thing. It's one thing that they got access to their database, but if they had been encrypted, that again raises the bar for the attacker. And they just weren't diligent with their secrets, right? The attacker was able to get all their API secrets stored in their source code. And on top of that, they didn't have two-factor authentication enabled for their GitHub accounts. I think across the board, you should require all users and all third parties that have access to GitHub or to AWS to log in with two-factor authentication. And then finally, right, the spam through Twitter and Facebook. If you had some sort of logging and alerting around the usage of your APIs, hopefully you would have detected that at 6 a.m. There was a huge influx in posts to Facebook. The next incident that we wanted to talk about was with respect to Snapchat. I think this one is more interesting and different because it really focuses on the response and the community outreach that your security program needs to have. So essentially what happened was an independent researcher called Gibson Security released a bunch of research on their API usage. And then a couple of days later, Snapchat responded saying theoretically, the Find Friends feature in Snapchat, which allows you, basically, when you upload phone numbers, it will give you the corresponding username to that phone number. They said, theoretically, if someone uploaded all the phone numbers for all the different area codes, sure, they would get the usernames. And sure enough, a couple of days later, someone took the theory and turned it into practice. And they leaked 4.6 million phone numbers and usernames. So Snapchat had to come around and say, we're sorry. And this was their second response. And I thought this response was pretty good and accurate. You know, they provided a timeline of what actually happened. They provided a response of how they were going to address the issue. And then they also had that line of communication. They said, if you find any other issues with our APIs or our app, contact us at security@snapchat.com. And sure enough, they eventually released an opt-out update so you could opt out of the feature. But a couple of months later, the FTC got involved. And FTC, basically they said, Snapchat, you marketed your application saying that you took privacy and security seriously. The recent events are depict otherwise, essentially. And the end result of this was pretty, not so bad, I guess. But they basically had to implement a privacy and security program, which has to be monitored for the next 20 years by an independent third party. So if you look at the play-by-play, you had the Gibson Security releases the research. And from a cultural perspective, I would have hoped that Snapchat at least knew that this existed. But I think the response, they angered the trolls. And the trolls came out and they said, oh, you think it's just theory? Let me prove otherwise. And then when the actual dump happened, I would have hoped that they would have had some detection or in response when someone started uploading 4.6 million different phone numbers to their application. So with that said, you know, here are the four takeaways, I think, for your application security program. And these are pretty cost-effective and cheap, I think. Don't keep secrets in your repository. Use two-factor authentication at least for your mission-critical assets like GitHub and AWS. Perform some basic error logging and identify that security champion within your organization, someone that's going to be that voice. And with that in mind, if you have any questions now, feel free to ask them. Otherwise, you can go ahead and come up here and talk to Anson or myself. And I hope you enjoy your stay in Denver and enjoy the conference.